Hey guys, this is Eric Young, and you're listening to Booking the Territory.
Hey, this is Ring of Honor Superstar Donovan Dijak, and you're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is the one man gang. You're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is Booking the Territory, a pro wrestling podcast hosted by Mike Mills, Heartbody Harper from Wildcat Sports and Entertainment, and the mentally irregular Doc Turner. This podcast is a mix of your topics and thoughts in the world of pro wrestling, along with interviews and discussions with current independent stars and your favorite stars from the past. And now, here's your host, Mike Mills.
Welcome back to this week's episode of Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast. Thank you for downloading the show. You know we always appreciate you tuning in and checking us out each and every week. We got another splendid episode for you this week. I've got a couple of Twitter comments and questions sent to us by you all, our wonderful listeners, that we will discuss and address. We've got our top five discussion this week, which is the top five guys WWE mishandled, which was suggested to us by William Shepard on Twitter. We're also going to discuss what is WWE doing these days and some TNA thoughts. And lastly, I had a brief but great talk with the current NWA World Champion, Godzilla Jax Dane, that is coming up later in this episode. Doc, how have you been, man?
I see you ran off Harper.
Harper is, I'm glad you said that, because Harper is not here with us tonight because Harper is doing commentary right now. As you know, Wildcat Sports on Saturday, September the 24th, 2016, launches their very first episode of their television show that will be broadcasting throughout the New Orleans metro area and along many parts of the Gulf Coast if you have Cox Cable, I believe. So, and don't quote me on that area exactly. Like, you know, I know there's probably people in parts of Mississippi that won't get it, Alabama, all that good stuff. But I'm just saying they're going to be in a lot of households, Cox Cable, plus they're going to be on, I think it's WUPL 54 in New Orleans. So Harper is doing commentary right now with actually Joel Gertner, ECW, former ECW star. So that, I didn't run off Harper. He's taking care of business, Doc.
Is that going to get all the way up here to Dallas?
You're a fucking idiot. That's what you are.
Big time TV star.
Oh, he is. He is. Fuck. Where are you on TV at, partner? Huh?
Hey. I'm just saying another case of when you get that BTT label slapped on you, your rocket ship takes off for outer space.
Okay. Doc, I just got a question, man. Did you get in all 5 hours of Raw and SmackDown this week? Actually, not 5 hours. Did you get in all 5 hours and 15 minutes of Raw and SmackDown this week?
Oh, yeah. And then I started, you know, eating healthy and sucking dick. What do you think? Hell no, I didn't watch all that shit. It's too much.
You got to get all hot about it. Jesus Christ.
Let me tell you something.
Getting all swole up in the chest, man. I didn't do it.
No, but it's this podcast. Let me tell you something. I watched all of SmackDown, and I watched it in less than 15 minutes on Fast Forward. That shit was awesome.
You're full of bullshit.
Hey, before I forget, I got a little shout out here to one of our wonderful Twitter listeners. You're a jackass, by the way. You gave your shout outs last week. Whatever this FF is that you do once a week, I don't know what that is. You shouted out a bunch of people on Twitter.
Uh-huh.
I just want to say Gravy Dog 316 shout out. You missed her. You missed her this last time, and you said you'd get her next time, and so I just wanted to jump in there and help out. You say I never interact with our fans.
You have no clue what that stands for. Follow Friday or something on Twitter. And all that meant was I was gonna include her in the next hashtag FF.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just trying to get more interactive with our fans.
You're a fucking idiot.
You say all the time that you got a terrible relationship with the fans. I singled out a young lady. I think she lives in Canada. We won't hold that against her because we may all be moving up there soon. And so I'm just trying to get, you know, strengthen the BTT relationship with the BTT Army.
Better be careful, man. Your Denim Fritz is going to get on you. That's Gravy Dog is Denim Fritz's. Is a groupie, as he says. Ain't that right? At the Eye of Gibson, if you're listening to us, and at Mullet of Morton. Y'all stay away from her, don't y'all, on Twitter. So, Jesus Christ. Hey, before we kick things off, Remember, our pro wrestling tee store is up. Check it out. Just go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/bookingtheterritory, and click the shop now button. You can get your very own Smoky Mountain Wrestling podcast tee. You can get your very own Booking the Territory podcast t-shirt as well. And if you're wondering who wins the t-shirt for the five-star review, I will announce it at the end of this week's show because West Dude never contacted me. So I had to select a new winner because I said I gave him a week, and the week went by and nothing.
This is like old-time territory wrestling too, ain't it? You're just trying to like keep us all strung along week to week to week. Oh, we'll announce who my tag team partner is next week.
Negative, asshole.
I think you're running a scam here. People, I've been telling you people out there in BTT land all about him for over a year now, and y'all think I'm the problem. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
Okay, since you want to go there, you know what? We're going to break fucking kayfabe, as they call it on this show. You like to fucking play heel on a podcast, and you're not a heel. So everybody, it's an act. He likes to piss you guys off because he thinks it's entertaining. I think he's fucking lame. But anyway, so just for the record, when Doc talks bad about you all, I'm declaring it now on September 22nd, 2016. He's full of bullshit is what he is, okay?
So you're saying I'm a cheery man of the people. Right.
You like to entertain them. That's all it's for. Mm-hmm. You try to rile up the you really try hard to fucking get the masses going, bro. You work up, you lather up the fans like Trump lathers up people. So let's not even go there before we get into a political discussion.
I don't need to talk about politics. I'm just saying that like every Tuesday or Thursday when we record now, I get a message from Mean Mike saying, "Make sure you lather up the marks tonight."
It's full of bullshit. You're so full of shit. It's not funny. Anyway, let's move on, man. Hey, before we kick things off into the meat and potatoes of this week's episode, I do need to say I gotta thank, and I know Doc will too, we gotta thank the great Brian Lass from the 605 Super Podcast for plugging and mentioning Booking the Territory and our Smoky Mountain Wrestling podcast on the Jim Cornette Experience that dropped today, September the 22nd, 2016. Jim Cornette, in the episode that dropped on September 22nd, 2016, said he would be coming on the Smoky Mountain Wrestling podcast this winter when his schedule slows down. He tweeted me last week and told me that, but he officially said it to all of the Cult of Cornette on his show this week. And you know what? Jim Cornette says some polarizing things when it comes to politics. I think he's great whether he's talking politics or wrestling, because I think the guy's funny and hilarious. But anyway, I love Jim Cornette. Always been a big fan of his since my days growing up in the Mid-South Territory. Met him at the Parade of Champions this year. Met him again at Oklahomania. He's just been busy. So he said he is coming on, Doc. I know you were quite happy because that is one of the podcasts that both of us actually listen to. You were quite happy with Jim and what he said.
Well, yeah, of course. well, we had a great – if you haven't listened, and I know most of you have, we had a great Smoky Mountain discussion that dropped last week with Brian Last, who has great in-depth knowledge of not only Smoky Mountain, but of just about seemingly every territory at every time period except the current time period. And his 605 Super Podcast. You know, I'm looking forward to being able to ask Corny. I call him Corny because we're good friends now that he's coming on the port.
Yeah, podcast. Okay, motherfucker.
I'm looking forward to really asking him some things that you and I have talked about throughout the whole four-year period of Smoky Mountain. But we'll also be this winter, we will still probably be well in the first year of Smoky Mountain. So probably focusing a lot of the discussion on how they got the promotion started and what were some of the early challenges and getting some of those hot angles that by the end of the first year are going, how they got them started and going in depth on those, I would think.
Yeah, I agree.
Because he's going to be a regular guest, you know, before long. So we'll just have him back to talk about the later stuff later on. Right.
Well, I certainly hope so. I mean, Brian brought a lot of knowledge to Smoky Mountain because that was, I mean, he flat out said it is one of his favorite territories. And I'm telling you, man, anybody who's listening to this that hasn't listened to our Smoky Mountain shows, it is a hidden gem. It really is. And you need to give it a chance, or at least try to give it a chance, especially if you're one of these people out there who are very upset, and not just upset, but just are not entertained by Raw and SmackDown. If you're bored out of your mind with that and you just need something else, the episodes are really easy to get through, not even an hour long. And it's just good stuff. So check it out. Come along for the ride with us with our Sunday shows for Smoky Mountain Wrestling. And yes, we are grateful that Jim Cornette is going to come on, and we are definitely looking forward to it. He said in the winter. I don't have a date, but I tell as soon as it's recorded, it's going up. Am I kidding, Doc, on that one?
No, you wet your pants earlier today.
Yeah, okay, you did too, but neither here nor there. I also need to give so again, Brian Lass, if you're listening, 605 Pod listeners, if you're listening as well, we hope you enjoyed our discussion with the great Brian Lass, and I'm sure, you know, you probably listened to the Jim Cornette Experience as well, and if you heard it, I just want to say, Brian Lass, thank you again, man. We appreciate the plug. I have not listened to the 605 Pod this week yet, so I don't know, Brian, as we record this on September 22nd, 2016.
He must have been sick this week. It's only 3 hours and 33 minutes.
Brian's a good dude, man. I really enjoyed that discussion, but I look forward to listening to his show because I'm sure he plugged it on there as well. So, again, TGBL, the great Brian Lass, thank you. We definitely appreciate you.
Can we stop blowing ourselves a little bit and start smashing the wrestling?
Smashing the wrestling. Well, I do need to say from Wayne G at Hot Shiznit 007 on Twitter, he tweeted me last week about Rick Rude winning the title, and I did a little additional research. It is a weird lineage where the title Rick Rude held was actually called the WCW International World Heavyweight Champion.
World.
He won it, I believe, on July 18th, 1993. He won it on September 19th, 1993. He held it for 178 days. It's a weird lineage that makes him, I guess, a world champion. But I think the point of it all when we were talking about it is the amount of people that just don't remember or even recall it. You know what I mean, Doc?
Harper remembered.
Which is shocking because
come
of,
on.
Of the three of us from a historical standpoint, I don't know. There's some things Harper is aware of in WWE from or NWA, WCW, that occurred from like 90 from 90 to 93, 94. Harper like seems to tend to be aware of those things in WWE, whereas you and I were like, we had no eye on WWE during that time, or some things with the NWA. Very, I don't know. But anyway, moving right along, I just want to say, Wayne G, thank you. Appreciate the tweet, man. Very, very, very strange lineage, but you know, technically, y'all are right. So fans out there, you guys are right. TNA, Doc. TNA is on right now. I caught the first hour of the episode approximately. It looks good. I don't know how much of a fan I am of the tournament at this point, but I'm willing to give it a fair shake and see what else happens with it. Last week on the September 15, 2016 episode, they drew 366,000 viewers. And Doc, the thing about it is they went up from last week over 8%, or the week prior to that. Raw dropped.
Football. It's all football. It's all football, right?
Well, if it's all football, why did TNA go up on Thursday night?
There's a football game on
Thursday night.
That's a good question.
Okay, so I just wanted to make sure I wasn't alone.
You know why? Because WWE doesn't have Senior Benjamin.
They don't, nor do they have Vanguard 1 in landscape mode. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you should be listening. You should be watching.
That's
it.
That's right. We ain't going to tell you. You should be watching.
Vanguard 1 went into landscape mode and helped out Senior Benjamin. I think it was a little racist, but whatever. The way it went down with the he blew the leaves out of the sidewalk. And Senior Benjamin.
You said something earlier, that King of the Mountain or whatever they're calling it now, and they got the rounds and the judges. I don't like that. But you know what? There's never been a wrestling show I've ever watched that I sat there for the entire time and went, ooh, I like everything I saw. But I'm walking away from the Impact shows more and more being more entertained than I am watching the WWE product.
And some of it is absurdity, the things that you're entertained about.
Jeff Hardy wrestled a fucking kangaroo.
Right. Literally locked up with him.
Smoking Joe Frazier, the kangaroo. And you know what? I laughed, and I've watched it three times.
I've watched it three or four times as well. Speaking of Impact, you know, again, they're progressing the storyline with the Hardy and Decay. Moose and Lashley, I wanted to point this out. Did you notice a difference between Moose and Lashley and their promo last week on the September 15th episode? And I say difference between that. I mean, a difference between the Moose and Lashley promo and Cena and Ambrose and Styles. Did you notice anything, Doc?
No. What was I looking for? Was it the fact that there were black men versus white men?
No, just a few words about them fighting at Bound. You know, they had a few words about them fighting at Bound for Glory. And then Moose says, yeah, I can't wait till Bound for Glory. And instead of, like, jaw-jacking for a while, he just starts slugging them and they go to brawling. And then they went real old school when Bennett came out and he comes out and he gets involved in it. And then EC3 comes out and then they go off air. It just was real old school. Like Moose and Lashley didn't sit there and jaw-jack for 20 minutes like Cena and Ambrose and AJ did the week prior on SmackDown Live. And actually, I'm a fan of SmackDown. I think SmackDown's a better product than Raw. But my point is, they actually, you know, back in the old days, you tell somebody they don't have balls, you know, you were getting fucking dealt with.
Hey, there's
somebody was laying some hammers to your head.
There's nothing I like better in wrestling than some good hot promos talking shit. But there comes a time when you got to drop the promos and start beating each other up.
And that's what they did.
And you saw it earlier in it last week's Impact when what Rosemary said that about taking Maxwell away from Rebby, and Rebby just said, fuck it, and came across the ring and started swinging.
Yeah. She's like, oh, you're gonna take my baby from me, call me a horrible mama? She's like, you know what? Fuck this shit. This fight, that's fighting words at that point. Ain't nothing for us to talk about no more when you say things like that. I mean, man, somebody knocks on my door and tells me, I'm going to take your kid and show him what a real dad is. Motherfucker, you ain't going to do nothing. You're going to fucking take this bullet to your fucking head is what you're going to do.
Whoa.
I ain't talking about shooting.
Make sure they're inside the house. This is Texas. You can wait. As soon as they get inside, you can do that.
Anyway, but my point is, man, it's just fake, phony, hokey horseshit, as Jim Cornette would always say.
Here's what we've got a real big problem, though. Our problems are not with what happened in the ring with TNA. They're doing good. The problem is that fucking Uncle Vince is sniffing around the door, maybe.
Oh, yeah. We got rumors and dirt sheet reports about Vince, who's interested in buying TNA. So, you know what, Doc? I said to myself, you know what? Fuck that. We're not going to talk dirt sheets. We're actually going to bring on Vince himself.
What?
Yeah, we got Vince on the line. Hold on 1 second. Brr-rum, brr-rum, brr-ring. Hello? Hey, Vince, welcome to Booking the Territory. Let me get this straight. Are these rumors, or are you really interested in buying Impact?
Goddamn, pal, what the fuck's an Impact? The only Impact I think of is when I'm laying a smackdown on what the fuck's my wife's name? God damn, pal. Shit, help me out.
You mean Linda?
God damn, pal, that's her name. I like laying the fucking wood and smackdown to Linda. That's what kind of Impact I'm about.
Okay, Vince, so there's the rumors of you buying... We're talking about Impact Wrestling.
God damn, pal, what's an Impact Wrestling?
You leave TNA alone, Vince.
Okay.
I'll leave it alone because I have no clue what the hell it is.
Well, Vince, what do you think of SmackDown almost doing equal ratings to Raw, you know, last week, not this week?
Huh! SmackDown? What the fuck's a SmackDown?
Okay. I don't know if that went over too well, Doc. Vince, we want to thank you for your time. We appreciate it. Can you come back if we have questions ever again?
Goddamn, pal. What the hell is that, tuberculosis?
Hey, shit. Doc, you got any questions for Vince?
No. Go away, Vince. You're out of touch.
Goddamn, pal. We'll catch you guys later.
Oof. Speaking of, what the fuck was that about? Speaking of Raw, the only thing on Raw.
Vince McMahon just did a run-in.
Speaking
of
Raw.
With a torn quad.
Well, that's true. Speaking of Raw, Doc, the only thing that entertained me on Raw this week was the cruiserweights.
They got that wrong, though.
Well, look, I don't want to be nitpicky. You can go ahead and say why, but I was okay with it.
You were all okay. Well, the 30. I don't have anything against Brian Kendrick. I actually find him entertaining, and I think from everything I've, you know, from my industry inside experts, he's a good dude.
He let me tell you, he really is. He works. I mean, now he's not, but, you know, he's been a Wildcat Sports guy. He's worked with Harper and those guys for for a while now. I think for a couple of years, but I know he's done a bunch of shows with them actually in 2016. So he'll be on their TV actually, I would say coming up. I don't know when, but, you know, how they're airing it. But, yeah, Brian Kendrick is a good dude.
He's 37.
So you didn't like the fact that, what?
He's 37 years old. I think right there I would have gone with Cedric Alexander in that match to go up against TJ Perkins at the pay-per-view, which I guess is this week. Who knows?
And it is.
Whatever.
And we're not even going to talk it.
Fine.
Talk about it.
I don't care. But, yeah, the match itself was fine. I just would have gone with Cedric Alexander going over there.
I'm willing to give him the benefit of the doubt.
Okay. I'm not. And they've lost that shit with me.
Well, no, I mean with that, since it's so new, I'm willing to give them the benefit of the doubt.
I heard it was great down at NXT, and I don't doubt that, and I don't doubt that they did a great job building the stories and all the making it.
Well, it wasn't NXT; it was a cruiserweight tournament, asshole.
Whatever. They made it seem like a real competition. They had the personal stories and the video packages. I'm gonna tell you, just like the brand split and the title, they're gonna fuck this up.
Well,
they can't help themselves. It's what they do.
Can't get out of it. They're like the Dallas Cowboys.
We're 1-1. We're 1-1.
Like the Dallas Cowboys, an accident waiting to happen.
Dak,
you're an
life.
Accident waiting to happen. Anyway, I think part of it too is we're partial to Cedric Alexander. Like to us, you know, ROH fans, we're partial to him. We want him. We want him to have that belt at some point. So, and we wanted him on a pay-per-view. But anyway, look, I'm fine with what they did. It was the first time. I don't think they buried anyone. It was entertaining, but we had to wait till hour three to get to it.
Should have put that up in hour one.
Well, you know, they had to fill it with time with a bunch of other stuff that I don't even remember what I watched, to be honest with you. Last week, Raw did a 1.88 rating, and then this week on the 19th, they did, I guess it was the 19th, I'm confusing my dates, they did a 1.97 and 2.684 million viewers. Boy, they're on fire, man, jumping up from a 1.8 to a 1.97. SmackDown did a 1.7, which was down from 1.86 the week prior, and they did 2.292 million viewers. So, yeah, that's your state of the business with the WWE at this point, just so everybody knows. Doc, I did not have this on the run sheet, but I'm going to go through it now. We did have a few of the five-star reviews that I promised I would read on air if we got five-star reviews.
Oh, my favorite.
So don't shit on any of these fans because they're good people.
Let me get
my pen out. Memphis History, five-star review says, Mike's an old-school guy that loves to bring his old-school memories to today's wrestling fans. Give it a shot. I appreciate it. That's Travis. Travis, thank you very much for the five-star review.
What the fuck? Are me and Harper just chopped liver?
You pretty much.
You hear that, Harper? I hope you're listening. God damn.
West Dude, this is who did not contact me, who originally won the shirt. West Dude said, Mike does a great job. His passion for the business shows. Keep up the great work. Dude, nobody mentions you. You are Harper. I got another one. It says, Infinite Thumbs Up, five-star review by QWERTY508. This is the dopest podcast ever. I didn't like wrestling until I started listening. Mike Mills is doing a great service to humanity by giving us wrestling as an outlet for our aggression. Hashtag booking territory. Joshua the Killer, Smoky Wrestling, five-star review. He says, if you dig Smoky Mountain Wrestling, then this is the podcast for you. Very entertaining show, and I must say that Smoky Mountain podcast was Doc's idea.
Mm-hmm.
There, give you some credit. And then the last one, Casey James, 87, another five-star review, says, Booking the Territory has become my favorite podcast. Keep the episodes coming. I appreciate all those five-star reviews, guys. We definitely thank you, and thank you for supporting the show.
Mike will kill himself by next Monday if we don't get a few more.
All right. Doc, I got a couple of polls, man. You like polls, don't you?
No. But it's okay if you do. I don't care what you do in your personal time.
Okay. So really the only poll I wanted to go through from @FunWWePolls on this week's episode is the question that they always put out, which one of these programs had the better show this week, SmackDown Live or Raw? And Raw came in at 22%. SmackDown Live came in at 78%. Shockingly, they also did a poll on – where is it at? There was one on the – what's your opinion of this week's episode of Raw? And they had great, good, okay, and terrible.
We're a shit show.
You were a shit show. That is a good option.
20% came in at great. 34% came in at good.
Hey, you know what? You forgot something real important. They beat another champion on Raw.
I was about to say that. That was the next poll I was going to go to.
The world champ.
26% said okay on Raw's episode. 20% said terrible. And they did ask a question about what was the opinion of the Owens versus Reigns steel cage match on Raw. Look, actually, people said it was 35% said it was great. It was 31% for good. 18% said okay. 16% said terrible.
Why would somebody's first match start out in a cage? It makes no sense. And why, if they've never laid hands on each other, did they already have the cage there?
Well, see, we're old school. That shit doesn't fly for us. But the problem, more than anything, with that whole thing was you got a pay-per-view coming up where Owens is defending. And
he lost.
He just lost, but he's fighting Seth Rollins for the title. Now, he didn't get pinned, so I will give them that. He lost because Reigns got out of the cage first. However, fuck that. You're still beating your champion, dude. You're still – see, let me say, I'm not as mad because think about back in the day. Rick would always lose, but it would be via countout. So it's kind of not as far stretched as that same philosophy when, you know, Dusty would win, but it was because of countout. It's kind of the same thing, but it's really not because they threw him in a cage. So I just don't want to see my champion lose constantly. At least he didn't get pinned. You know what I mean? Because we did say that. If you remember, the stipulation was if you pin your champion and defeat your champion clean. Because a countout.
I got to admit, I forgot. And even though it was the end of Raw, I didn't wait around for the end. I turned it off when that shit happened.
Bro, I think it was almost 15 minutes into the overrun by the time that shit went off Monday night. Unless I was just delayed on my DVR. Anyway,
it was the most exciting part of Raw because I was like, these motherfuckers are going to beat their champ, aren't they? And then I was hooked and I wanted to see if they beat their champ, and damn it if they didn't. And see, it was the only thing that kept my interest the entire time.
They were listening, bro. That's why they waited till the end, because they knew you were going to turn it off.
Well, Vince is a listener, apparently. He called in to tonight's show.
They did, man. We heard from Vince, and he couldn't even figure out his wife's name. All he wanted to say was, God damn, pal. Hey, we got a couple of tweets, though. The Mullet of Morton says, I love hashtag 605 pod, but the BTP pod guys have a good show, too. Great Smoky Mountain Wrestling show with Brian this week. Sue the Shooter from Great Brian Lass's show says, let CJH Harper know I'm taking him to Splash Mountain. Sue the Shooter. Hey, Doc, here's a really good one. This one is from – can you hear me? Because it sounds like you're breaking up.
No, I'm right here, buddy.
Okay, this one is from Gino Hernandez at Gino's Baked Goods. He says, my top five rats I do lines off of. Sherry Martel, mm-hmm. Elizabeth, mm-hmm. Pre-Luger, mm-hmm. Trish Stratus, mm-hmm. Miss Kitty, and Paige. She's a ghost.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think, you know, Harper likes to no-sell some of these tweets, but when we get off there, he really puts over Gino's Baked Goods.
He does. When I hit the stop button, he's like, brah.
Talk about brah. I think, you know, he's trying to no-sell y'all and be strong in the ring, but Harper loves you guys out there.
Yeah, he does, man. He does. Let's see what else we got, man. Sue the Shooter says, all rats do matter, but this bitch has a tallywhacker, Ricky. Evidently, Morton posted a picture of Hillary Clinton. Sue the Shooter said she's got a tallywhacker, Ricky. Oh God, yeah, some very entertaining stuff. Anyway, so
I'm pretty sure that the fake Stan Lane and the Mullet of Morton and the Ive Gibson don't really understand that they are all parody accounts and are trying to start a real tag team war again.
You know what? That may be true. That may be true.
I'm going to say this, and let me just go ahead and get on his radar. Denim Fritz is out of hand.
Denim Fritz is out of hand?
Yeah, he's just everywhere these days. I saw him on the Facebook page blowing it up on 605. He's everywhere.
He's taking over, dude.
Denim Fritz is trying to get his come up.
One of his tweets this week, he said, just had to put the claw on a 94-year-old man. He had the gall to take the last box of raisins in a breakfast line. Chris Adams just told me Ralph Pulley loves tube steak. I got to say that I think I prefer the ribeye.
Ralph Pulley was one of the ring announcers here in Dallas, for those of you who don't know.
Chris Adams just told me Ralph Pulley likes to play hide the sausage. I'm telling you right now, you hide sausage from me, it's on. Chris Jericho has the worst botched boob job this side of a $5 hooker. He's off the chain. Anyway, I just had to read a few of them, man. Denim Fritz, we love you. Thank you for supporting the show, man. You're always good to us. The last one I'll read from Denim Fritz. This is awesome. You know you're dealing with a pro when she removes her dentures for love time.
Sir.
All right. Doc, I had a couple of thoughts. I'm going to read both of them and we can tackle them. And then before we get into our top five, this is the last topic we have before then. So this is from J_FWillITT89 on Twitter. He says, if a wrestler doesn't get over who the writers are pushing, who should get fired, the wrestler or the writer? I don't know if we want to go as far as fired, but I would say, who do we blame? And then he also says, what do you do when the writers can't get you over, even with the machine behind you? Doc, what are your thoughts on that? If whose fault? Who do you put the blame at? Do you put it on the blame of the writer or the wrestler?
More times than not, I'm going to blame creative in the company.
Me too.
Although I don't think you can blanket say it's always one or the other, because I think there are varying levels to which the talent will embrace an angle or a gimmick. And I think if you think about where you work, and certainly where Mike and I work, not everybody works at as hard as everyone else, and not everybody's as good as everyone else. So there are guys probably, and I don't know who they are. It's hard for us to sit here and say because we're not there. But more times than not, I think, and some great example, a great example for that for me is if you watch TNA and look at the year that Bobby Lashley at 41 years old is having, in my opinion, it's the best year of his career. And he has really changed his persona. And did it click? I don't know. But maybe the company just got out of his way.
I blame creative more times than not. I mean, it's probably 80% of the time it's on creative, especially at the WWE level. You're not talking about an independent level at this point anymore.
And the real problem here is WWE doesn't know heat. They don't book heat. And that's why this shit all falls flat. And they script it. And some pasty faced guy who doesn't know a flat back bump can't script a guy to talk shit about kicking another guy's ass.
Well, and I always go back to what Michael Tarver always said when he was on the show a bunch of times. You know, here's a guy who was in their system. Here's a guy who was at FCW in NXT when it first started. You know, a guy who was up on the main roster for a little while. And his flat out comment was, every guy that's on that main roster, they not only can go, more times than not, they have a personality. And it's just that, you know, but if they don't give you shit to work with, you will not see an outcome of good performance. I blame the company. I mean, how else does a EC3 or a Damian Sandow get away from WWE? Just think about that in itself.
I think
those guys
were
in that system.
That's one side of it. And I think the other side of it is you take guys who are so charismatic that they got shit over. Look at the New Day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there is another part of it, too. I agree.
Now, not every guy can do that. So, like we talked about, wherever you work, not everybody is the same. You got guys that are better than others and ladies. But you take Big E and Xavier and Kofi, and they are so charismatic, they got bullshit over.
But see, here's the thing, and I'm not comparing New Day to Roman Reigns, but I will say this. With New Day, they were allowed also to organically become heels after they were first portrayed as baby faces. So, you know, Vince, and I've heard the podcast that they did with Jericho where Vince was like, God damn, pal, you're going to go out there and be positive black people. I mean, And they said flat out, you know, this isn't going to work. They're not going to take to us. And sure enough, they got the shit booed out of them. There was no power or positivity. And they organically allowed them to be heels. And they got over as they began to get over as heels and people hated them for what they were. Then they became baby faces. Now, contrast that with what they've done with Roman Reigns, trying to make him a baby face. They keep just pushing that boulder up a hill. Well, guess what? You can learn something from New Day. Roman should have been a heel. So, again, like New Day was first a baby face, Roman was a baby face. They should have allowed him to organically transition to a heel. And if that would have happened, he could have been a baby face by this point. But they've pushed that boulder up a hill for so long, they're just fucking idiots. So that's why I say it's creator's fault. I mean, yeah, New Day got it over, but think about how organically they were faces, heels, and now faces again, where Roman hasn't been given that opportunity by creatives.
Faces, heels. Is this some kind of carny talk that only you...
No. I mean, okay, I'm sorry. Good guys and bad guys. I mean, come on, man. Fuck ever. But anyway, so, hey, J_FWillITT89 on Twitter, man. I appreciate that. I know you listen to us each and every week, man. So thank you very much, man. We're grateful for it. All right, Doc, we got top five to discuss. And top five this week is WWE's Mishandled. So
this
top
is the five hardest category we've done yet.
I don't know. I'm going to say hardest.
This was my hardest five to come up with. And the reason is because there's so many guys that the WWE has shit on and mishandled over the years that there's so many possibilities.
Yeah, there are a lot. I will say this. I just did a mix, and you'll see exactly what I mean by when I say I did a mix when I did my top five. But, hey, before we get into it, I do want to say this week's top five – you know, I always do a lot of online research for our top fives just to do some additional reading. And, you know, I mean, a lot of, we grew up watching two territories and then WWE as it became real popular.
I watched NWA, brother.
Well, what I mean is, you know, we grew up, you grew up world class and an NWA fan, and I was a Mid-South NWA fan, and that's when those territories were a part of the NWA. Point being that, you know, we're not Brian Last. We don't have that level of knowledge of every single territory that guy has. His top fives a lot of times would be different than us, and he wouldn't have to do half the research. So I'm just saying, in doing some research, it is terrible how skewed pro wrestling history is being written because of Vince buying everyone up and shutting down all the territories.
Goddamn, pal, I was just trying to make the business great again.
Shut up, Vince. As the legends of the territories die, the history is going with them, and WWE is writing the history books, and it's not accurate. And that's what I got out of these top. Like, I say that because as I'm reading about some of the people I had in this top five, you would be amazed the spin that not only WWE, but people who write and research these people, the stuff that they get that's directly from WWE. And they use it to classify whether a guy was a good worker or not. I'm like, whoa, bro. Did you even watch Mid-South? So that's where I'm going with that. WWE.
I guess you put Junkyard Dog at 1 through 5.
Yeah, no. So top five guys WWE mishandled. Doc, kick it off with your number five.
Shit, I almost just said, how about the entire current roster? Let's close it down. Harper, hit the tagline.
Hit the tagline. who you got?
My number five is a very – so did we also – we said, because it would be very easy to just go to the current roster, we said one person from the current roster. Is that correct?
Yes, that's what I did. I'm glad you mentioned that. I did. I did include one person from the current WWE roster.
Okay, me too. Me too, right. And my guy is a recent roster, current roster. My number five is ADR, Alberto Del Rio, because I think you have a guy that's, I mean, I guess, a handsome enough guy. I'm comfortable enough to say it. He's big. He's got an incredible build, and he is the Hispanic superstar that could be the face of the company to that community and reach out to that community and draw them in, and they shit on him. First of all, they turned him heel the first time, and then the second time was a complete abortion. I've read a recent interview with Dutch Mantel, and he comes in and it's just like, why are you guys putting me with him? We don't like one another in the storyline. So, and
yeah,
he comes in, he beats Cena the first night in like 7 minutes. And then from there on, he gets stuck with shitty angles, shitty gimmicks. And it's like, why did you guys work so hard to bring him back if this is all you had for him?
Dude, they almost ruined Rusev with that League of Nations shit too that they did.
Yeah.
Just think about that. I mean, whether you like Rusev or not, he's a hell of a guy that they have. I like him.
It just goes back to the idea that real businessmen figured out a long time ago that to expand their markets, you have to address and speak to the Hispanic community because it's such a growing segment of the population. And WWF and WWE have largely refused to, outside of Mysterio and Eddie Guerrero. And Eddie Guerrero crossed over, but I think ADR could have been that guy to carry that torch. And that's why I say you're more likely to get Juan Cena than you are Alberto Del Rio.
You saying old white guys don't want to let the Hispanic population, Latinos, into the limelight?
Hey, what, though? That's all right. Because you know what I find where I live? The Hispanic population is super duper in love with the Dallas Cowboys, and y'all are always welcome over here with us.
Shut up. You just gave a compliment that was a insult. You're an idiot.
My Hispanic listeners out there know what I'm talking about, and you know they love them some Dallas Cowboys.
He's acting stupid. He's trying to play heel again. But anyway, I can't disagree with that number five. Not on my list, but I can't disagree with him. So my number five, this won't shock you, Doc, because we've talked about this person many a times, actually. My number five is Terry Taylor. And I won't spend a lot of time on this, but I'm going to say two words. Red Rooster.
Well, and I've heard guys say that, you know, he didn't get that over. He didn't embrace the gimmick.
Well, hold on. Younger listeners, if you hear me say this, Red Rooster, that is, and have no clue what I'm talking about, because it's relatively old at this point. It's over 20 years old at this point. It's actually closer to 30 than 20. Go search WWF Red Rooster. Vince took a guy who was a great talent from the Mid-South and UWF territory and the NWA, and he made him a fucking rooster. A fucking rooster. Taylor was a one-time Mid-South North American champ. He was a two-time Mid-South TV champ. Let me remind you, these are when these belts mattered. All belts matter. He was a two-time UWF under Watts tag team champ. That's what Mid-South became after they were Mid-South. He was a two-time UWF TV champ and a one-time NWA World Junior Heavyweight Champion. And for people who don't know, back in the day, the World Junior Heavyweight Champion, NWA, was a big deal. And he held a few other NWA, WCCW, and even a Georgia Championship Wrestling titles. And Vince took this guy, and he made him a fucking rooster, and he shit on him.
And it was and he shit on him so bad that the stink was on him when he went back to WCW, and he never really recovered from it.
It was terrible. So that was my number four, Terry Taylor.
That was your number five.
I'm sorry, number five, Terry Taylor is the Red fucking Rooster. The Red Rooster. Mm. Yes. My number four is, this is not going to shock anyone, Roman Reigns. I'm a Roman Reigns fan.
Wait, that's your current guy?
Yeah, guy that's actually on the roster. He's on their roster.
Gotcha.
Roman Reigns, look, I'm a Roman Reigns fan. Roman Reigns takes too much shit from people who have no clue what they're talking about with him.
You mean like
now, if you just don't like him, that's one thing.
That's me.
But I don't like when people say he can't wrestle.
That's me.
I think the company has not done him any justice. They put the world title on him, yes. I understand that. But titles aren't always everything because The Miz was a world champion at one point. They've got this guy incorrectly casted, as JR says. I've heard JR say it a million times. They need to let him lean into being a heel, going back to what I said a little while ago when we made the New Day comparison, and go with it organically. I don't understand how a company that got rich off the Attitude Era with Austin and The Rock and Mick Foley organically will not do the same thing with Reigns. Look, we beat this thing. It's a dead horse at this point with Reigns in the past, so I won't do it again. But this guy is mistreated. He's shit on in ways that, you know, many other WWE stars couldn't deal with it. And I just hate the way they portray him and cast him. He needs to be given more credit for trying and sticking with it and doing it for so long than he's given. Because they shit on him. But he is shit on left and right.
I don't like the guy, but I can't argue with that pick.
Of course, they shit on. So give us your number four.
My number four is a guy you will not agree with because you do not like this guy.
I'll spit the fucking number four out.
My number four is, I'll use his WWF name, Dean Douglas.
That's not that I don't like him.
Did not, in my opinion, get any semblance of a fair shake in the Federation. He's known as an opinionated guy. He's known as a guy that has burned bridges, but he got sideways with the Click. But it's another case of he was an edgy guy in ECW, and he came over to WWF. He got this Dean Douglas. He's so smart because he was a high school history teacher part-time. And, you're the dean, ha, ha, ha. And, you know, he tried, apparently his story is he tried to give feedback on it and change it, and the writer said, no, no, no. Again, kind of a reoccurring theme we're going to have here. He won the Intercontinental belt at a In Your House. He lost it later that night. He kind of got buried soon thereafter because he was up against the Click. So he didn't have a good gimmick. He got buried by politics and was back in ECW within a year.
I don't know if I have anything against Shane Douglas. I don't know the guy. I don't know. I don't think he deserves that slot, a top five slot.
I'm a huge Shane Douglas fan for his ECW work, and so to see it get interrupted by going to WWF for that bullshit, I don't like
it. Hey, what's your number three?
My number three, if you will, baby, is why you gotta put the American Dream in polka dots.
He got that shit over. That's the only reason I didn't put him on my list, because he got it over so good.
He went back and forth off of my list two or three times over the course of the week because of that. And I was like, and it really goes back to our discussion a minute ago from what's his name, Jay Flitty 89 or whatever, that some guys are such a force of nature, and there's not many, that they can get over bullshit. And Dusty still got over polka dots.
Well, Bruce Pritchard says it wasn't.
I love that podcast he's got out now. I listen to it every week, and I do not believe a word he's saying about that.
Well, he makes some validating points. I mean, he says, look, you know, why would we invest money into a guy and it be a rib?
Why would you take a charismatic force of nature like Dusty Rhodes and put him in polka dots? That's the best you can do? Then you should get fired for that.
Okay. I mean, look, I'm not all right. I believe Pritchard. I won't lie to you. I do believe Pritchard. I do. Hey, Doc, I hate to interrupt our top five. Did I mention who our guest was this week at the top of the show?
Yeah, I think so. You said it was the NWA World Champion.
Yeah, I'm like drawing a blank. I'm like looking at my notes going, did I even mention that we got Godzilla Jax Dane coming up shortly on the show? He was this week's guest.
We had that other guy at work that we know that likes wrestling. He was saying the NWA World Champ's not a big deal anymore. I said, you better go tell the Jax Dane that to his face and see what happens.
Jax is a big dude.
He sure as hell is.
Yeah, you might not want to tell him that. But anyway,
did he beat Tenzan for that, for the strap?
He beat Tenzan. He beat Tenzan for it.
Yeah.
He's been champ for over a year now. So anyway, man, I just want to tell him thank you again while I was thinking about it. I can't remember if at the top of the show I had mentioned that we were bringing him on a show this week.
Quit drawing attention away from your shit list and give us your number three.
My number three is Shelton Benjamin. And keep in mind, hear me out, because I know we said only one person current roster.
He's not current.
I know, but he was going to be, so there's some, you know, speculation there. But here. Do I need to say anything more than Big Mama when it comes to Shelton?
God damn.
While Shelton did win some titles, like he was, I think he won a U.S. title once. He was Intercontinental Champion a few times as well, I think three. And WWE Tag Champ with Charlie Haas a couple of times. They could have done so much more with him. Shelton is still one of my favorites that the company could do more with from a talent standpoint. Now, I know as I say this, there were plans to bring him back to the company in SmackDown Live when they found out. But they found out he needed shoulder surgery, so that didn't happen. So hopefully, you know, he makes a full recovery and then we see him come back and maybe they'll strap a rocket to him because he deserves it. But Shelton Benjamin mistreated Big Mama. That whole thing was just... Yeah.
How much bullshit do you think he took in the locker room with that shit from the boy?
I mean, dude, I never worked for that company, obviously, but I can tell you just flat out wrestling, especially in the indies, you know, back when we were in the cars for hours at a time going, you know, shows on a weekend, there was lots of ribbing, lots of fucking making fun of people. You know, he probably took some. I mean, you're going to take that anywhere you're at.
This is a physical fighting sport where you got to man up and you got to have your mama come out and settle your battles.
Right.
It didn't work in WCW with Bagwell, and it didn't work here.
Yeah, it was terrible. And the thing is, like, this guy, he not only is a super athlete as far as his agility, he is a fucking amateur fucking, you know, master. I mean, he's a technician. Like there's, to me, I don't know if there's anything he can't do. Shelton Benjamin can do it all.
He couldn't get over getting saddled with his goddamn mama out in the ring.
That's the only thing. But I mean, again, they shit on him. They shit on him with that. They crapped on him. Shelton Benjamin, very, very talented, man. So hopefully he gets another run and they do something with him and don't crap on him, you know, once his shoulder's healed.
Y'all leave Shelton alone. He's going to have to go call his mama.
Jesus, they mistreated that dude. My number two, you're going to love this. I know you're going to love this. I got a feeling he's on your list, but, you know, we'll see. My number two is Raven. And here's the thing about that. I never was a fan of Raven in ECW.
You're a moron.
I didn't begin to really appreciate Raven until after ECW, and it's even been within the last 5 years or so. I've gone back and watched a lot of his ECW stuff that I lived through watching and, you know, watch it as I'm older. And I heard, you know, I've heard a lot of big name stars talk about him and how brilliant he actually is from a wrestling perspective all around. He made his WWE debut in 2000, which his WWE run lasted less than 3 years. If my research is correct, he got a couple of runs with the terrible hardcore WWE title, which was just complete bull crap.
But that's when they started the whole belts don't matter bullshit.
Right. Do I think Raven deserved to be WWE World Champ? Nah, I'm not going to say that. But there are far more prestigious titles than the hardcore one from the WWE, as I recall. And you know, God, I mean, they put him in feuds with Saturn that involved Moppy and Terry. Yeah, I mean, you don't even know what I'm talking about as I say that, everyone listening. Okay, you do, but I just shit. I mean,
because Saturn's on my honorable mention list for that bullshit, because he had a fucking mop.
Right, they just crapped all over this dude. So Raven is my number two, Doc.
You know, and I think, in my opinion, Raven's 95-96 world champ run in ECW, he's in the conversation of top three in the world at that time. What he was doing in those arenas as the champ with his entourage and the belt and the Dreamer stuff, that dude was and with Paul maximizing his ability, that guy was at the top. I mean, he was really firing on all cylinders. Not on my list, though.
That kind of shocked me, but yeah, man, they crapped on him. Who's your number two?
My number two is my current roster member. He was number one earlier in the week, and he fell down to number two. I'm going with Bray Wyatt. I think that guy gets, first of all, he's one of the only guys on the roster that can cut a promo that doesn't have a tagline in it necessarily. So he can talk.
But they let him ramble too much with it, too.
They do, which is part of how they don't help him, right?
Right, right, right. I agree.
They take the rough edges off, yet they keep him a heel, so he can't really heel out. He's got charisma. The whole crowd fires up the lights when he's coming out, so he can get the whole world in the palm of his hand to use his gimmick. But he's always going to be hamstrung because he can't take that gimmick as far as it needs to go. Look at Decay Down South, what they're trying to do, or the Blueprint, which is Kevin Sullivan's run in Florida with the Satanic gimmick. They beat him every fucking chance they get on a pay-per-view.
He sure the fuck do.
I mean, so I don't know how he's expected to get over or supposed to be menacing when all he is portrayed as a fucking guy who lays down for the pin. I don't know what would happen if he and Dolph Ziggler ever faced each other on a pay-per-view. They might just ring the bell and both lay down for the pin. They abuse him so bad, his character, in my opinion, that I ended up leaving Dolph Ziggler off, who's a better, in my opinion, worker and seller, but they've abused Bray more because of the character. They've done it injustice.
Boy, you ain't kidding. The more we do this list with the top five most abused WWE, you ain't lying. We could put Dolph in there,
Cesaro.
Bray.
Cesaro.
Everybody, a whole fucking roster. that's actually I didn't have Bray, but yeah, of course he's mistreated. No doubt. You ready to roll with your number one?
I sure am.
Who you got?
Your ass better call my mama. My number one was your number three. My number one was Shelton Benjamin.
Wow.
A three-year running 2005 through 2007 Wrestling Observer's Most Underrated Wrestler of the Year. Amateur teammate of Brock Lesnar. Tag team champions with Brock Lesnar and OVW, who they beat Cena and somebody else. I can't remember who.
Was it Rico Constantino?
Might have been. I don't know exactly.
He's not doing well. He's got a GoFundMe right now, I believe. He's in real bad health. But go ahead.
A guy who poked through, you know, the Intercontinental U.S. title tag team thing, but could have been so much more. We talk constantly about what's the ceiling for a black man in the WWE. I always hate to think racism, but let's be real. I wonder if that always had something to do with it. I also, just that's a guy who, and then to take all that into consideration, you saddle the guy with his mama. It ain't his mama, but you get my point. We've talked about that already. Just brutal. The guy, he's 41 now, so you've got to think that even if he can come in and do something, his best, athletic years may be behind him, his prime behind him. Hopefully he can reinvent himself like Jericho's done. But you talk about wasted opportunity. He left the WWE in 2010. So he was 35 when he left. You're telling me that at any point in the last 20 years, the WWE's roster was so chock full that they didn't need a 35-year-old in his prime, Shelton Benjamin.
Immensely talented. I mean, people who are listening to this that are like new WWE fans and maybe didn't get to see his run and just how good that guy is and how they've mistreated him. The thing is, I've heard Jericho talk great about him. I mean, there's so many people who like MVP, like the people who have gotten over there and they did do great things with will tell you, they won't tell you that WWE mismanaged him or mishandled him, but they will sing Shelton Benjamin's praises.
And
that dude is great. And they did not do anything with him.
And his tag team partner in the world's greatest tag team, Charlie Haas, might be a contender for this list too, if we're going to be honest.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, you probably could. You probably could.
All right, so I was surprised that he was on your list, to be honest. I thought I was going to skate through and get that. But when you said it, I mean, it makes sense. The guy was criminally underused and mismanaged in the Federation. So what else is new?
Before I get to my number one, I just want to say, remember, I'm going to announce a T-shirt winner at the end of the Jax Dane interview. And I do want to say, since we're in the middle of this, I want to thank our sponsor, the Wrestling Palace, located in Traders Village. For those of you in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, my buddy Arturo over there, you can contact him at 469-337-8537. Literally, he's got anything and everything you could want as far as wrestling memorabilia needs go. He's got it all. So if you don't live in the area, check him out on Facebook. Just search the Wrestling Palace, and I'm telling you, give him a call. He will answer, and he will make arrangements to get what you or find what you need if he doesn't have it, and he will get it to you. So I just wanted to plug him for everything.
I bet you do want to plug him. You sorry.
And if this is your first time listening to us, subscribe however you are listening to the show right now, whether it's Podbean, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, or TuneIn Radio, whatever. Just subscribe to the show. So, all right, Doc, back to it in my number one.
Here comes the Junkyard Dog.
No, no, no. I don't know if the Junkyard Dog was treated badly by WWE. I mean, they weren't going to put the world title on him. We talked about that. I mean, when Hulkamania is running wild, you think they're going to put the world title on JYD? No, it ain't going to happen. There's a lot of people they weren't going to put it on during that time. But my number one, this guy was shit on, and he would turn shit into gold constantly. Damian Sandow. I like when he did the intellectual savior to the masses gimmick. I didn't like it per se when I first saw it, but he got it over, in my opinion. I was doing some research, and I recalled when longtime listener and friend of the show at T-Hog94 on Twitter mentioned to me him winning the Money in the Bank contract back in 2013. Unfortunately for Sandow, unlike most people who do cash in, Sandow lost to Cena when he cashed in. So, you know, because Cena really doesn't put people over at that point. Although he's put over AJ recently. And I think this, you know, to me that killed any momentum that Sandow would have had at that point. We know by the end of 2014 and through 2015, they straddled him with the stunt double gimmick to The Miz, which really felt hokey. But if you recall, Doc, that was one of the things every Monday on Monday Night Raw that got over. So once again, Sandow got some shit over that was a bit of a joke, if you ask me. So he did his job. And then after that, they throw the Macho Man parody on him. And, you know, just one thing led to another. And before you know it, he's gone from the company. They released him. And I will just never forget his TNA promo when he said, I was labeled as too entertaining to be taken seriously or to be given a real shot at the world title.
That's a lazy answer.
But think about it. You're too entertaining.
No such thing.
Just you know, WWE and their crap, whatever. So those are our top five. So I'm going to run through mine real quick again. I had 5 Terry Taylor, 4 Roman Reigns, 3 was Shelton Benjamin, 2 was Raven, and 1 was Sandow. Doc,
I had Alberto Del Rio, Shane Douglas, Dusty Rhodes, Bray Wyatt, Shelton Benjamin.
Yeah, that was a fun one. That was a hard one, too,
because here's my honorable mentions, bruh.
I'm listening.
I had Saturn on there.
I can see that.
I had Carlito on there.
Okay.
One Man Gang, Akeem.
Yeah, well.
They made a white man with no rhythm a black man when he was just an ass kicker everywhere else. Too Cold Scorpio. They made him Flash Funk.
Okay.
Here's some interesting ones I want to get your opinion on. Terry Funk.
They mistreated him? Well, they definitely did a Chainsaw Charlie.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Red Dog.
Oh, Rodney Mack. Yeah.
Rodney Mack. Even his gimmick, I mean, they didn't push him, but that white boy challenge was funny.
Yeah.
Couldn't do that today.
Oh, hell no. Hell no.
Now, here's two that I think at first you're going to say, huh? But hear me out.
Okay.
Jerry Lawler. I'm talking about in ring, not his commentating. You're talking about the King of Memphis. And when he came up, he was in mid card and at best, you know, getting a shot every once in a while with the Hearts. But that's a guy who I think was mismanaged because he was from the South. And Vince doesn't like things that come from the South. So I don't think Jerry Lawler ever got enough runway to do what he could have done in, on that stage.
I can see it, although I wouldn't have included him in mine, but I see what you're saying.
And along those lines, and this is going to be real hard because you could say he had greater fame doing the WWE bullshit than he did, but I have Hacksaw Jim Duggan, who was an ass kicker in Mid-South and became a buffoon, a money-drawing popular buffoon, but a buffoon nonetheless, just going, oh!
Yeah, I mean, I guess. I can't disagree with any of your honorable mentions.
And then the entire current roster has a beef that they're not on this list.
Well, my honorable mentions were, I got Zack Ryder on there. Mm-hmm. I actually got Taz, ECW Taz on there.
Maybe.
Dolph Ziggler is on there. I actually put a tag team on there because for people who saw these guys only in WWE, they'll never know how vicious they were. But I had the Bushwhackers on there because as a fucking sheep herders, those dudes were just murderers.
Scary.
I mean, they were savages, dude. They were savages. I mean, it's hard to explain how Luke and Butch were savages, but they were savages.
They were
like
you know who they were? They were the scariest tag team before the Road Warriors came along.
Well, they were just savages, man. You really thought like they would truly gut you and eat your heart and your intestines and insides out. So they were just brutal. And then they became the Bushwhackers, and they were like just as cartoons.
Buffoons.
So, yeah, and so they were mishandled.
And you know, Vince has seen a tape of the Briscoes and been like, goddamn, pal, there's the Bushwhackers part two.
Yeah, we talked about that on like our very first episode of this show over a year ago. Definitely a lot. The thing with this, there were so many, it really was hard to bottle up and do five. Doc, real quick, I want to do something before we head on out of here and jump in and throw it over to the NWA World Champ, Jack Dane. So let's go through these matches from Clash of Champions. I know you don't give two shits about it. Alicia Fox and Nia Jax, who do you got?
Nia Jax.
Kevin, I got Nia Jax too. Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins, who you got?
Kevin Owens.
I got
Owens
as well.
They got to pay off that angle with Triple H.
Well, they don't have to do
that's
anything.
True.
They,
that's
like,
true. That, right. Okay, never mind. I don't know who's.
But it is for the WWE Universal title. Or we're going to piss off WWE. It's for the Universal strap, brother. The New Day versus Gallows and Anderson's for the tag straps, Doc. The Raw tag straps.
Boy, they've shit on Anderson and Gallows so much, they might have to give them the title just to make up for it.
I think New Day retains, but it wouldn't surprise me. We got the triple threat for the women's match. One of the I'm actually looking forward to it, of course, because my girl Sasha's in it. Charlotte, Sasha, and Bayley for the WWE Raw Women's title. Give me Charlotte. Who you got?
Yeah, give me Charlotte as well.
Ain't hot potato and that son of a bitch at this point. They just took it off of Sasha.
No,
they're not
I mean,
gonna.
They
give
gotta
it back
keep to it on Charlotte, so they gotta keep it on Charlotte so they can pin her Monday night.
And so that Sasha can take it from her at WrestleMania this year.
Whatever.
And just what I think.
She's
got to
get pinned. She's got to get beat a lot of before then.
Yeah. Sami Zayn and Chris Jericho.
Jericho's not there to get over like that by winning, so give me Sami Zayn.
I do too, because I think Jericho – well, you know what? Actually, give me Jericho. Sami Zayn takes a lot of pinfalls and still stays over. So, Rusev versus Roman Reigns for the U.S. title. I think Roman Reigns wins this title.
Boy, that would be really telling if he does, because I think it would be the admission that he's been demoted based on his suspension. I think somehow Rusev snakes out a dirty win, and they're not really ready to put that mark of demotion on Roman Reigns yet.
I think that's already happened. I don't think that will signify it. I mean, he's demoted by the mere fact
I don't know that it's a demotion. I like Rusev.
Well, I was going to say that, too. I think they put it on him. And look, Roman's going to be back in this Universal title picture at some point.
Whatever.
Just look at the roster. He's going to be back in the picture at some point. Cesaro and Sheamus, I actually like both of these guys, and I really like Cesaro, but final match in the best of seven. I actually called it originally. I said, you know, one of them was going to go up 3-0 and the other one's going to storm back. So, Doc, for argument purposes, for the sake of no argument, I should say, I got Cesaro. Who do you got?
If Sheamus wins, we riot.
TJ Perkins and Brian Kendrick for the Cruiserweight Championship. This is going to be a very good match. I wanted to say something about this. TJ Perkins, Doc, you know where he's from?
Yeah, he's from TNA. He was doing time in a dumbass angle down there.
Right. So anybody, I say that for people who like to bash TNA. You know, you got a guy like this who's all up there. Everybody's in love with him. Well, hey, he's been in TNA for a while when Doc and I were watching.
And they mismanaged him.
They mismanaged him a lot, as you can see. So I think Perkins wins. There's no way Brian Kendrick wins this. But, Doc, actually, this is not a bad card, to be honest with you. Because I am interested in Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins. And I'm interested in the New Day. And the women are going to do a good job in a triple threat. And I do want to see Roman and Rusev. And I want to see Perkins and Brian Kendrick. So I'm actually looking forward to this card on Sunday.
I'll give you this.
You got to admit, this actually looks better than SummerSlam.
It's better than I thought it was before we started reading these matches off 5 minutes ago. But the Cowboys are going 2-1 Sunday night. So you know where I'm going to be, brother.
Wait, y'all play Sunday night?
We sure as hell do.
Okay, so y'all play Sunday night. We play Monday night. So you know what that means. I'm doing
we're
Monday
gonna
night.
Be cobbling, we're going to be cobbling together next week's show by did you see this? Did you see this? And then
yeah.
We'll make it look professional for the fans like we always do.
But I am not watching Raw next Monday.
I'm not watching Clash of Champions next Sunday night.
I fully admit the Saints are probably going to do the job. Nate Milton, if you're listening to your Atlanta Falcons, but you know what? I'd rather watch them do the job than watch 3 hours of Raw. That's going to
be me and all my Hispanics. I bet Hispanic viewing of Clash of Champions is down because we're all watching the Cowboys.
Hey, buddy. Hey, you know, that almost wraps it up. Like I said, so hopefully you enjoyed this week's show with the top fives and all that we discussed and what we did discuss as far as Raw goes this week and just wrestling news, TNA and all that good stuff. Look, I just want to say again, it was really cool talking to Jack Stane. We have to do it again sometime. The interview gets cut short because he was in a bad area. He was on the road on the phone, so we got cut short. We didn't really get to finish things, so it kind of ends a little bit abruptly. But I just want to give you all a heads up as you're listening to it, and I mentioned it too at the end. Also, just again, thank you, Brian Lass, for our Smoky Mountain show that you did on September the 18th, 2016. And please, if you listen to this, check out our Smoky Mountain shows, man. They're really good stuff. And we had a great talk with Brian Lass. And we cannot wait to talk to Jim Cornette. If you haven't already done so, subscribe to the show. Follow us on Twitter at @BTT_podcast. I'm at @Mike504Saints. Doc doesn't do Twitter because he's just an idiot. The man's got a PhD, but he can't figure out Twitter. And also, while we are at it, I wanted to say, check out our Amazon referral link. You can find that at mikemills.podbean.com. There's a link. Just click it. It is if you're shopping on Amazon, we get a very small kickback. So shop there, load up your cart. Like I said, small kickback. It's a way to support the show where you're not actually spending any more money than you'd already spend on things you'd already be buying. And if you just happen to want to donate, there is a PayPal donation in the show notes of this week's episode. Follow us, like us on Facebook as well. Check out our YouTube channel. And Doc, I think I'm all out of plugs at this point.
Book it.
Are you there?
Book it, baby.
Actually, I'm not out of plugs.
God damn, I hit the tagline, fucker.
I did that on purpose to you. I got to shout out the King of the Mountain podcast about their Impact Wrestling reviews that they do each and every week. So if you are a fan of TNA like Doc and I are and Impact Wrestling, check those guys out. They actually do a full review of each week's Impact show. And also I need to shout out the great classic wrestling podcast, Brian Lass's 605 Super Podcast. And lastly, before we get out of here, I do need to shout out the WPAN, the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing with our friends, the Kingpin, Brian Malonis, and Mike Crockett. Thank you for always mentioning us each and every week on your show. You guys are a great new show that's building an audience with your current product discussions weekly on Sunday nights, early Monday mornings. And again, they've had a couple of our guests that we've had on as well. Donovan Dijak and, Warbeard Hansen have been on their show. And both very good discussions, much different discussions than the ones we have with those guys. So check them out. Now, for Doc and Mike and Harper, who's not here this week, here is our discussion with the NWA World Champion, Jax Dane. Doc, hit the tagline.
John, you better tell them to book it, bitch.
Oh, man. Enjoy the discussion, everyone.
All right, everybody. Like I said, I got the NWA World Champion on with us today on Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast, Jax Dane. Jax, welcome to the show.
Thank you guys for having me. I appreciate it.
Hey, anytime, man. You know, I've had James Beard on my show a couple of times, and I was talking to James via Facebook after I had him on a couple of weeks ago, about 3 or 4 weeks ago now. And I said, James, I've been wanting to talk to Jax Dane for a while now. Can you make that happen? Does he do media appearances and whatnot? And I figured you did, but you know, I had to ask James, and James is like, oh yeah, he's like, I'll hook it up. It wasn't even. Maybe 4 hours later, he was messaging me back. Contact Jax. He'll be glad to do it. So I appreciate it.
Hey, no problem. You know, when a guy like James Beard, who probably, I think, without question, is one of the most respected personalities, referees, bookers in the industry, when a guy like that calls you and asks you to get in touch with a guy or make yourself available for somebody, just out of respect for him, I mean, you almost have to make sure that happens, and you have to make sure it happens as soon as possible. So I just have a lot of respect for James Beard. He talked really, really highly of you guys and how you treated him and your show. So, you know, out of respect for James and respect for you guys, I just tried to make it happen as soon as possible.
I appreciate it. Yeah, James and I have a very close mutual friend, Rod Price, which I'm sure you're pretty familiar with from the old days of the Sportatorium and Global Wrestling Federation. So, yeah, it made it pretty natural. James, you know, Rod hooked me up with James about a year and a half ago. He did my show first, and then he came back and did it again, and it was cool. I always like talking to James because James and I – James is I love talking to the guys that, you know, with that old school, that they can talk about the Bruiser Brodies and the Terry Gordys. You know what I'm saying?
Right, absolutely. And you know, he lived that. So
yeah,
it's not just – his perspective is so unique because he lived it. He was in the ring with most of those guys, whether it be here in the United States or even overseas in Japan. So getting his perspective on a lot of things has been really, really good for me. I mean, he's been very helpful for me and my career and the evolution of Jax Dane and Godzilla, and especially in Texas. So I'm just real thankful for him, have a lot of respect for him, and would do anything he asked of me.
Yeah, he was telling me, I hadn't planned on asking you this, but he was telling me about a story. I think he said it was you that you were asking him recently, because he and I were talking about Terry Gordy. And he was saying that recently you were talking to him about Gordy and, you know, how he worked as a big man. And I don't know if you're quite as big as Gordy, but was that you he was talking about, or am I thinking about something else?
No, it was absolutely me. I had found a pretty obscure link online, and it was Brody and Gordy and a couple of others. And I sent it to James and asked him to watch it. And he and I had some conversation about it and just how those guys worked their size and had very few wasted motions. And you're right, I'm not quite as big as Terry Gordy was, or as big as Bruiser Brody was. But Terry Gordy, believe it or not, he had a lot of inspiration in my wrestling career. I'll tell you a quick story. Back before he passed away, he used to train, lift weights at the World's Gym in Hickson, Tennessee. You know, right outside of Soddy Daisy, where he once lived. And I was in the gym training, and at the time I was a basketball player, and I can't quite remember how old I was, but I remember I was old enough for this to stick and for it to matter. And Terry was in there training, and he came over to me, and he introduced himself. Of course, I knew who he was, and we talked for a little bit, and he told me, he said, kid, if you do anything with your life other than wrestle professionally, you'll be wasting it. And he walked away from me. And then we would say hi mutually, in the gym, and at that time, you know, granted, I was still a high school basketball player trying to get to college, but that conversation stuck with me. I went on to play college basketball. Once I got finished playing college basketball, I decided to pursue a career in professional wrestling, and here we are. But, you know, it's kind of ironic, kind of neat how that one interaction might have foretold the future, and we didn't even really realize what we were doing.
Dang. That's a cool story, man.
Yeah, man. And he was an enormous human being. I was just enamored with his size, you know, at that time.
Well, you, Jax, I'm born in 1975. I grew up in New Orleans. And, like, to me, I grew up watching Mid-South, which was a big guy territory, guys just kicking the shit out of each other. And, of course, we got World Class down there as well. So, growing up watching World Class, I, as a kid, the prime of my, I would say, viewing of professional wrestling was watching the Freebirds and Von Erichs. So, okay. Gordy was larger than life to me. So, I've always been a Gordy fan. I mean, the guy was just, I mean, he just was a monster. So, yeah, man, that's a cool story, man, to have a guy like that tell that to you.
Yeah, man, it was a neat deal, and it stuck with me my entire life, man. It's kind of neat. Yep.
That's cool, man. Hey, I always I kind of segued at the beginning, but I always like to kick off the show whenever I'm talking to guests by asking them some non-wrestling-related topics, you know, because I know you get tons of wrestling-related, you know, questions all the time, and I find – you know, when I bring guys on, like I've talked to, I've had guys on like Donovan Dijak, for one from Ring of Honor, and Warbeard Hansen. And I'll ask them, I'll go, you know, hey, man, non-wrestling related, were you a fan growing up of other, you know, pro sports, like, you know, football, basketball? It sounds like you had a little bit of a basketball career. So, man, were you a fan of other sports? Who were you a fan of?
Absolutely, man. I mean, I grew up loving college and professional basketball. Obviously, I played in college, so you don't get to that level without falling in love with the sport. But I mean, I was a huge fan of college basketball and professional basketball back in the 90s, late 80s, all through the 90s, man. Jordan, Magic Bird, Barkley, Karl Malone, you know, just that era of basketball. I think basketball is almost like professional wrestling to me. In that time frame was more of a basketball purist. Basketball's evolved a lot, and the basketball players today are great athletes, and the size is unbelievable, and the things that they can do physically may be a little bit more advanced than what we did in the 90s and late 80s as college and professional athletes. But, man, I'm just a purist when it comes to basketball. In that era of David Robinson and Hakeem Olajuwon and that time frame, man, that's what I love. That was my passion for a very, very long time.
I agree. I mean, I grew up on Jordan and all them. So, you know, you grew up watching that as a kid. You know, nothing against LeBron and the current product, but it doesn't hold a candle to the late 80s, early 90s to me and what I viewed then from a pro perspective.
Absolutely. And like wrestling, basketball, sort of the same way. 31 flavors, man. It's like Baskin Robbins. Everybody likes something different. And that's why so many people can find success in what we do.
Yeah, you got it. You got a good point, man. I was just curious. Like I said, it's always piques my interest related to other pro sports. Just the interest level that guys have. Because I know, I mean, I was always a pro wrestling fan, but I mean, in a nutshell, man, I also was a big New Orleans Saints fan, still am to this day. You know, in the NFL in general. So yeah.
Absolutely.
Me and James's mutual friend Rod Price. I'm gonna make a statement, and you tell me what you think about this. Rod has always told me for 20 years now, and knowing him, that pro sports is a work, just like pro wrestling. I'm gonna throw this at you. Do you think there's any whatsoever truth to that statement?
I think anytime there's millions of dollars involved, an outcome can be determined. We'll leave it at that.
There you go. I swear, when I'm watching this, sometimes I'm like, man, this is a work.
You know, day in and day out, I think it would be almost impossible at a professional level to control every outcome and make it what it is. But I think anytime that you've got millions and millions of dollars involved in the results, I think some form or fashion it can be controlled or altered. Or, you know, but that's just my opinion. It doesn't mean I'm right.
Yeah, I hear you, man. I say the same thing on my show weekly, especially when it's football season, man. We get on these rants, and I'm like, dude, did you see the finish of that game? Somebody was booking that territory. But we have fun with it, man. It's just to have a good time and break up the just serious talk. So, hey, I was doing some research on you. Now, Wikipedia might be wrong, so just correct me if I'm wrong here. Were you 28 when you made your in-ring debut in 2009, or is that incorrect?
That's fairly accurate.
Okay. I was curious because when James and I were talking on this last go-round, you know, he started later in life, too, in professional wrestling. You know, he wasn't an 18- to 20-year-old when he got started. And I was wondering, you know, being that you were a little bit older, you feel like starting later in life helped you?
Well, my career is a little – the path was a little different. You see, I went to Ohio Valley Wrestling at one point to be trained. That's where I started. Dr. Tom Pritchard, Rip Rogers, Benny right. Davis, Nick Densmore, Rob Conway, those guys. So I went and got trained for a couple of years. Had a handful of matches, but not even what I would call an in-ring debut. Then my mother was diagnosed with small cell lung cancer. So I stopped wrestling completely, moved back to Tennessee to help take care of her. She got better, moved out to Texas, took a corporate job, moved out to Texas, got the itch to start wrestling again, and started small. And then the next thing you know, it just exploded. But between the time that I was at Ohio Valley Wrestling and the time I moved to Texas, I put on about 50 pounds. I was training to be a bodybuilder. So the guy that got trained at Ohio Valley Wrestling and the guy that moved to Texas were almost two different people. But the training base that I got at Ohio Valley was just amazing, man. I mean, anytime that you cut your teeth with Nick Densmore and Rip Rogers and Rob Conway and Tom Pritchard, you're probably one of the luckiest professional wrestlers on the planet.
Yeah. Yeah, I hear that. I'm going to reach out to Rip Rogers soon. I want to get that dude on my show because he is like I read his tweets on Twitter, man. He's unreal.
Yeah, man. He's an absolute genius at what we do. I learned so much from Rip, and I'm so thankful for him. The early part of my career and the foundation that he gave me day in and day out, especially psychologically, he's just, if you can handle the way he communicates, you can learn a
right.
whole lot from Rip. I mean, you know, not everybody can handle the way he communicates. He doesn't believe in sugarcoating anything, ever, for anybody. I mean, he's blunt, honest with you, and I respond well to that. So I'm very thankful to Rip and the foundation that he gave me early on in my career.
Yeah. Yeah, he's definitely He definitely tells it like it is based on what everyone I know that's talked to him, know him. You know, you can see it on Twitter, man. He don't give two shits. He's just firing off, man.
Absolutely. It's and quite frankly, man, for me and the way I like to be taught, I would much rather have it that way. I'll process that and make the change or do the best I can with it, where some guys like to be tiptoed around. Even though they may say they don't, they do. So I like Rip style. Like I said, I learned a whole lot from him. I'm very thankful for him, and I wish I could spend more time with him now.
Yeah, he's what – look, man, for what it's worth, you know, even his style is, like, in your face, man. All the who's who of wrestling, the community, they respect him. And that's, you know, that's enough, if you ask me. So.
Absolutely. And you know, there's a lot of guys that there was an era there where Rip was training – almost all of the major stars for the WWE. So,
yeah,
you know, the guy's smart. He knows what he's doing. It's if you can handle the way he communicates. If you can't, he can teach you a lot.
Yeah. Amen to that. Jax, now I'm sure you've gotten this question before, and so my apologies if this is a repeat one, but you won the NWA World title in August of 2015. We're recording this on September 11, 2016. You're working on close to 400 days since winning the title. You know, I'm just wondering, what went through your mind the night you won the title, not only knowing the history of the NWA, but, you know, just everything you've been through throughout your wrestling career?
Oh, man, well, as far as my wrestling career, it's the greatest day of my life. I mean, everybody knows the prestige and the legacy that comes with that belt. I mean, that title, that championship. I mean, we can name, I can name the who's who of who were the champions, but I don't think we need to. I think it pretty much speaks for itself. You know, even in the early years and to when it was at its peak, and even into the late years of guys like Tenzan, Kojima, and Conway. I mean, all three of those guys extremely accomplished in their own right. So, you know, to win the title from Tenzan was pretty special for me, especially since he and I had wrestled and competed against each other several times over in Japan. Being able to wrestle him in San Antonio at the time in front of what I considered to be my home crowd was really, really special. And then, you know, it was my first match back after I had torn my tricep. So I had surgery on my tricep. I'm trying to remember exactly, but I think it was only like 16 weeks, 15 weeks from when I had my tricep completely repaired until the night that I wrestled Tenzan. So the recovery was pretty intense, man, and we just busted our ass to try to get back in shape. And I owe a lot of that recovery to Ray Rowe. I know you mentioned Warbeard Hansen earlier. Ray Rowe is my former roommate and best friend in the world, and man, he was there for those long nights of a painful tricep and shitty workouts. And every time I had to go to the doctor, he went to the doctor with me. Every time the doctor said, there's no way you're going to make this timeline, he would say, we're going to make that timeline. So, you know, I had a great support staff with my father, Ray Rowe. I mean, I was just Rob Conway. I was just blessed with guys around me that pushed me to get back in time for that match. So personally, it was an uphill battle. But then, you know, when you win that title and James Beard is the referee and you win it from Tenzan and it starts to set in what's happening, all that work, man, it didn't really seem like a lot of work at that point. It just seemed like a culmination of a dream come true.
Yeah, that's a good story. Yeah, that's wow. I mean, you know, we don't have to say the names of the NWA champions. I mean, you got the Ric Flairs, the Harley Races. But you may mention, you know, the recent champions. Yeah, you talked about, like, Conway and Tenzan. I mean, you know, Rob Conway is, God, he's so good. I mean, you know, I hate when people leave WWE because they kind of fall off the radar, and they really shouldn't, and it's only because they don't have the machine behind them still. And that's right. No disrespect to him. I mean, he's a hell of a talent. It's just that, you know, unfortunately, I guess mainstream the machine is not putting you on TV in front of 3 million people every week. So, but he is a hell of a talent. You're right. As one of the recent champions, man, you look up to, like you said, even recent champions, there's still a lot of prestige there.
Well, absolutely. And you absolutely can't forget Adam Pearce either.
I'm sorry. I missed him. You're right.
You know, I mean, I think 5 times world heavyweight champion and I've got a lot of respect for Adam. He's a personal friend of mine, and he did a great job with the NWA world title in recent years as well. So, I mean, for me, being able to just be in line with those guys and obviously the legends of the past, that's something that 20 years from now I'll be able to look back and say, hey, I was part of that group.
Yeah, that's awesome. And Pierce as well, working in WWE now, NXT, right?
Yeah, there's
behind the scenes, obviously.
There, man. Yeah, there's a reason he's there. He's smart. He's kind. He treats people well. He's everything a professional wrestler should be, should aspire to be. And I'm just real happy for his success that he's found down there outside of actually lacing up the boots, because a lot of guys, they love this industry and they love this business so much, but once the opportunity to lace the boots goes away, they really can't find a way to express themselves creatively. But Adam, man, he worked really, really hard, and he's ended up in a great spot, and he's doing a fantastic job with NXT, as you can see with the product they're putting out. I mean, he's directly got his hands on that, and NXT's got a great dude in Adam Pearce down there.
Definitely, definitely. Jax, what's it been like the last year traveling as NWA champ? We kind of alluded to it before we started recording a few minutes back, but I'm just curious, what's it been like?
Oh, man, it's life on the road every weekend, whether it be a plane ride or a short drive. You get into a town, you meet with the promotion, you know who you're wrestling before you get there. So you just try to go in and entertain the fans and give them a smash mouth match, because that's what I do. And then I try to make sure that I interact with every fan that I can and represent the NWA and the world title and the champions that have actually held the title before me, I feel like I'm their representative right now. So I just want to make sure that I carry this thing with as much class as possible and give a good showing everywhere we go.
Most deaf, man. Most deaf. I mean, obviously, you're doing a good job of it, considering it's been over a year at this point.
Well, you know, that's, I'm pretty proud of that title. It's going to take a hell of a man to come take it from me.
I hear you. I hear you. Yeah, I, you know, you were talking about the night you won it, and you and Ray, you know, Ray helping you out with your tricep and whatnot. I actually remember, now that you say that, it just clicked in my mind. I was at there was a Smash Mouth wrestling show in June of 2015, Randy's show. I was there, and I remember seeing you, and I think you still had a brace on your arm at that point in June. Am I remembering that correctly?
If I'm not mistaken, that was we did some special stuff for Brody that show, Randy's son. And
yep.
Yeah, I was there. I just had surgery. You know, Randy invited me up. Anytime you get a chance to help a guy like Randy Blakely out, he's a first-class human being. He's set a hell of an example over the past. Oh, man, I don't even know how long it's been. Ever since Brody's accident, man, he set a hell of an example of how you should handle your business and support your family and do the very best you can with the situation at hand. And I'm proud to call him a friend. He's an inspiration. I love Brody to death. I think Brody shows us all that no matter what hand you're dealt, you get off your ass and you do your best you can with it. And he's finding success. So, yeah, I was up there. I was part of that event. And was really happy to participate in that.
Yeah, it was a cool deal, man. I enjoyed going. Randy invited me that night too, and it was fun. And yeah, Randy and I were just texting actually yesterday about the VIP show that took place in DFW just this past weekend on the I think it was the 8th and 9th or 9th and 10th. I get my days mixed up. But yeah, we're talking, and yeah, first class human being. You got that right. And the way Brody has fought back is unbelievable, especially when you know the full story, when they gave him no shot at even living from what
zero shot it was.
Yeah, I mean basically 0.00001% maybe, and that was a big maybe. And look at him now.
I think he started working with Randy this week, didn't he, at the office?
I think so. So, Randy, if you're listening, man, we're putting you over. See, I'm not taking jabs at you this time. I take jabs at him every now and then because we're cool.
Yeah, he deserves a jab every now and then, but for the most part, man, that dude has been really good for professional wrestling in Texas and really good for me personally. He reaches out. I reach out to him, and we have a very, very good relationship. I'm real happy for him.
Absolutely, absolutely. Hey, I've gone on record and saying we're seeing somewhat a resurgence of what I would call a modern day territory system in wrestling. I don't mean in the same blueprint of the NWA that I grew up watching in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s. I mean in respect that while you have WWE, you know, there's also ROH that you have guys earning a living at. There's TNA you have guys earning a living at. You have Lucha Underground, a little bit different of a wrestling presentation, but you know, where talent is earning a living at. And, of course, the NWA is doing things to hopefully get back and maybe get a national TV deal at some point. Are we seeing – let me ask you this. Are we seeing a modern-day territory system emerging in your eyes, or how do you view it?
Yes and no, in my opinion. And here's why I feel that way. One, I think the territory system that we had before I think it was because professional wrestling, let's try to figure out how to say it. In a sense, the territory system before, you had guys work territories and then go to another territory and work that territory, and guys were on rotation a lot in the old territory system, and that's how you kept the product fresh. I think the difference now is there's so much media out there. There's so much social media. There's so much so many avenues where you can look at guys and see guys. Even on the independent scene now, if a certain company advertises a guy that you may not be familiar with, hell, with a click of a button, you can look at him and see if you want to go watch him or not. So I think there's a lot more jobs out there right now because there's a lot more people engaged because there's a lot more ways to watch what we do. I don't know if that makes sense or not, but
No, it does. I've made that point how social media, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, has actually put more guys on the radar that you may not have, you know, known of before because it just wasn't possible because you didn't have the way to get the product out to people.
Absolutely. You know, growing up, you had Saturday night's main event is what you had. And then you had Raw and you had Nitro. And then you had the weekend show and the half-hour show here and there, and then you had pay-per-views, and that's the only way you could watch wrestling. Now you can watch wrestling 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, whether it be through YouTube or Roku or the network or the NWA Classics. And guys are actually, where in the past, for you to become a star in the past, one of the big companies had to grab you, had to put you in that spotlight, and had to push you in that capacity. Now you can build a following, you can build a brand, you can build you can build yourself almost into a star. I don't want to say without one of the major companies latching onto you, but how many guys now, and you see it especially in who's on top at the WWE right now, how many guys now climb the ladder and build a huge fan base before they ever debut at the big company?
Most definitely.
You know, I think that's the difference between now and the territory days. In the territory days, the wrestling was great. But now guys have the ability to build their personal brand and become an asset to a company prior to ever signing a deal with that company. And I think that's unprecedented now. I think that's what's driving the wrestling industry now is the social media.
It is, and that's why I said when I mentioned modern day territory system, that's why I phrase it like that, because obviously it's never going to be like it was, you know, in the era I grew up in, late 70s, early 80s. I'm viewing it more from, you know, there's more companies now than there's been in many years, and not only that, but there's independent organizations that are drawing great numbers that you never saw, you know, 10, 15 years, or you didn't see as much 10 to 15 years ago.
Kind of
where I was going.
Absolutely. You've got the Rocky Mountain Pro company up in Denver that has the Mercury Matt Yaden school tied to it. It's an NWA affiliation. You've got what Chase Stevens and those guys are doing over with the Arcadian Wrestling. They're doing a great job. It's like you said, the ability to promote and advertise and push your product now. All the NWA promotions that have the ability to advertise and push their product now, you're more visible than you were ever able to be in the 90s, early 2000s. So now I feel like there's so many more jobs out there for guys to have. And like you said, the most important part is earn a living at it. I know guys at Ring of Honor that are earning a living. I know guys at TNA, WWE, Lucha Underground are all earning a living and paying their bills. And it's the first time in a long time outside of the WWE so many guys are able to provide for themselves.
Right, and that was kind of my sticking point as I was mentioning that, because I see it. You know, I'm happy, like, when I watch guys that are in Ring of Honor and that I've interviewed on the show, that they can go out there and not only earn their living, you know, working for Ring of Honor, but working for, you know, different independent organizations. Same for TNA. It's refreshing to see that there's so many people out there that can now earn a living that aren't, you know, WWE guys, that aren't in that system.
Absolutely. A perfect example of that is my real good friend Ray Rowe. I mean, he's under contract with Ring of Honor, and he wrestles independence. That's all he does, and he provides for himself. He provides for his family, and all he does is wrestle professionally. And without being at the WWE or even TNA, that's pretty amazing that he has the ability to provide all his financial needs from just wrestling professionally.
Yep. He and Hanson, God, I love that tag team. I told Hanson that when I talked to him. They're awesome.
They're amazing, man. They are. You know, it's hard to compare them to anybody before. They're just so fun to watch. And I was fortunate enough to we wrestled in a six-man together at Pro Wrestling Texas in Austin, Texas one night, me, Ray, and Todd. And, man, it was awesome. We had so much fun as a six-man. Hopefully we get to do that again down the road sometime.
Yeah, it's incredible. Like, I was when I was talking to Hanson, he was at Todd we were talking about the recent, you know, TV that they did with Keith and Shane, and just how in Ring of Honor, you know, there's so many, we call them juniors or light heavyweights, and how they had been working, you know, with mostly smaller guys. And it was kind of, you know, new and cool that, you know, now they had Keith and Shane there, and they're able to work with some bigger guys. But yeah, I agree, man. As a tag team, I never forget the first time I saw both of them come out. I'd seen Ray, you know, on independent stuff, but seeing them together coming out, you know, looking like they're about to literally bite somebody's head off. They're right. So good at what they do, man. The word I told Todd and Hanson was they're so believable. It's incredible.
Absolutely, and then. In their own right, Keith and Shane are almost the exact same way. Two big yep. dudes that are very believable at real Smash Mouth Wrestling. So, we're real lucky to have three of those four guys in Texas almost full time. And then we're real lucky to get to watch Todd or Hanson and Ray on TV just about any time we want.
Totally agree. Hey, Jax, just a couple more questions, man, because I really appreciate your time as you're on the road driving down to a show. You've probably kind of mentioned this because you've mentioned how Ray Rowe has been real helpful to you, but you've mentioned kind of Rip Rogers and some of the other folks in OVW. Is there anyone else throughout your career that's been most influential to you? And, you know, not just who initially trained you, but, you know, people who've helped you along the way. Again, I know you've kind of mentioned Ray Rowe, but anyone else?
Well, I mean, absolutely. And it boils down like this, and I would tell this to anybody. Jax Dane would not be where he is or what he is today without Rob Conway. And I can't verbalize that enough, man, because he took a guy that literally was 6'4", 300 pounds, trying to figure out what to do with his 6'4", 300-pound frame. And he almost, I don't want to say single-handedly, man, but he had so much to do with my psychology and my approach to my matches and everything from how I go to the ring to how I leave the ring to, you know, I was extremely fortunate early in my comeback of my career to tour Japan with Rob as my tag team partner as part of the Iron Gods when we won the NWA World Tag Team titles. So I got to travel with that guy for a year over in Japan and really, really embrace the things that he wanted to teach me. And out of all the guys, I mean, Rip gave me the foundation, and Dr. Tom's been supportive, and Ray Rowe's been there. But of all the guys that are most responsible for my successes, there's no doubt in my mind that it's Rob Conway. He basically built Godzilla from the ground up, and I couldn't thank him enough. I'll never be able to thank him enough.
That's a great story, man. Great story. And again, we talked about Conway a little while ago, too. Just the he is so talented, man. I've seen him in person. I've seen him on TV, man. He's a great wrestler. And it's good that he contributed to you and your success, man. That's awesome. Good story.
Oh,
good
man.
Stuff, man.
I don't know how to verbalize it well enough to make you understand how important he is to the evolution of Jax Dane and Godzilla. And as great as he is in the ring and as smart or as good as he is wearing the boots, man, his mind is 10 times better than the wrestler he is. And we know how great he is as a wrestler. He's just really, really smart, one of the smartest guys in our industry, and I'm really, really lucky to have had him contribute to me as much as he has.
Okay, gang, unfortunately, that is the conclusion of my conversation with the NWA World Champ, Jax Dane. What happened was he was traveling when we were talking, and unfortunately, he got cut off, and he just did not have good service for the remainder of that day. So we really couldn't finish and wrap up the episode like we really wanted to. So I've extended the invite for Jax Dane to come back on in the future and talk a little bit more with us, talk about what he's got going on. But I just wanted to mention, if it sounds like it ended abruptly, that is why. So, Jax, I appreciate you coming on the show. I really thank you for your time that you spent with us on Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast. It's very appreciative of you taking the time and recording with us while you're on the road and heading to a show that day when we talk. So thanks again, Jax. Like I said, during the midway portion of the show, I needed to make an announcement for who would be our T-shirt drawing giveaway winner, and that was because West Dude on iTunes never reached out to me via email or Twitter. So to be fair, I need to pick someone who is willing to reach out to me. So we were a 5-star review, and I thank West Dude for rating us 5 stars, but I never heard from him. So West, if you're hearing this now and you sent me something, please tweet me either at Mike504Saints or at BTT_podcast. But as of now, I do have to or email us bookingtheterritory@gmail.com. As of now, I am going to pick a new winner. So the winner of the drawing for this week, I'm sorry, for the five-star reviews is going to go to William Shepard, who I think I know who he is from Twitter, and I know who he is from iTunes because it's his name. So, William Shepard, I need you to email me, bookingtheterritory@gmail.com, or send me a DM at BTT_podcast. Direct message me your address, and I will make sure we get the shirt out to you as soon as humanly possible. So, again, William Shepard, you were the T-shirt winner, and I appreciate you. Appreciate your five-star review, and we'll get you out your T-shirt. So I just wanted to get that out there. All right, last thing, last couple things. Thanks again to the great Brian Lass on our Episode 3 of Smoky Mountain Wrestling that dropped this past Sunday on September the 18th, 2016. If you're into classic wrestling like we are, please give our Smoky Mountain Wrestling podcast a try. I'm sure you'd like it. You can subscribe to it on the same feed as this one. And check out Brian Lass' show, the 605 Super Podcast. It's a classic wrestling podcast, one of the best classic wrestling podcasts there is, bar none. And if you're a first-time listener to us, please subscribe to us, whether it's on iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, TuneIn Radio. However you get your podcast, please subscribe to the show. Kindly write us a five-star review on iTunes or Stitcher as well. That would greatly, greatly help us. And then follow us on Twitter. We're at BTT_podcast. And I'm at Mike504Saints. Hardbody Harper is at CJHWhoDat. And then subscribe to us on YouTube. If you're a YouTube listener right now, man, subscribe to us on our audio platform, because I don't always get a chance to upload all of the episodes to YouTube. So if you're listening on YouTube, you can take us on the go and not have to watch us or view us via YouTube. You can take your audio on the go on the device of your choice. No matter how you get podcasts, you can listen that way. We'd appreciate it. Check out our Amazon link at mikemills.podbean.com. If you're already shopping on Amazon, please use our Amazon referral link. It is a way to support us without spending any extra money that you were, you know, weren't already going to spend. So if you're buying something on Amazon frequently, please go to mikemills.podbean.com. There's an Amazon link at the top of that page. Click it, you know, and then you can go to our referral page, start loading up your shopping cart, check out. We get a small kickback, and we definitely would appreciate it if you do that. We also take PayPal donations. That's in the show notes. You can see the link in the show notes that you're viewing this on in the description of the show. And then like our Facebook page. Again, follow us on Twitter. And I appreciate you all listening, tuning in each and every week to Doc Hardbody Harper and I, even though Hardbody Harper wasn't here today. So keep those top fives coming, those suggestions, keep them coming. We'd love to hear some more. Thanks again to all of you. Before I forget, man, I'm always forgetting something. God damn, man, I can't keep on track for nothing. I do need to shout out a couple of people. One, I got to say again, thank you to the King of the Mountain podcast, our friends from the King of the Mountain who do a strictly TNA review show. So if you're a TNA fan like many of us are, and Doc and I are these days, check out the King of the Mountain podcast. Check out their Impact reviews that they do each and every week. They usually drop them but sometime between Saturday, Sunday, sometime as late as Monday. But check out BQ and the King of the Mountain. Also, check out the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. Friends of ours, the Kingpin, Brian Malonis, and Mike Crockett do a good show. Different topics on wrestling every week. They've had some great interviews, such as the ones with Donovan Dijak, Warbeard Hansen. Really, really good stuff from the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. Check them out, and you'll enjoy them as well. So I think that's all I got. I appreciate everybody tuning in. Thanks again. It was a lot of plugs, a lot of thanks and all that. So you guys are the best, man. That's all I can say. We appreciate you tuning in. Thank you very much. And like Harper always says before we get out the door, book it.